some of the issues that I think will be addressing today came up yesterday, and I'm sure you have already thought about how one would address public spaces when there's a possibility of actually bringing technology to them. So I'm here just to launch the workshop. I'm just going to say a few words, and then I would leave it in the capable hands of our crew here from CCS and the School of Architecture. But let me say some of the few thoughts I have. First, I want to address the title, Hacking Public Spaces. Some of you who have already involved in activities like this already know this on this word. Hacking, in this instance, does not imply anything nefarious, right? The term has been accepted to designate the possibility of citizens getting involved in shaping things, whether it's policy, governance, public spaces, because there's something about the technology that we are using that lends itself for massive participation. So hacking means the possibility of becoming involved in the process of shaping the city. So it's a very positive element. Do you have any thoughts about that? Was that something that you already knew and participated in? Maybe some of you have already taken part in hackathons before. And the term hackathon comes from hacking, and it's something that actually many municipalities have been organizing to get their citizens involved in actually in participating in thinking about technology and utilizing the resources available by means of technology, just in getting involved in this. Another thing is this, and this is really the central theme of the workshop, is getting away, trying to question this idea that the smart cities and the potential that they hold has all to do with this kind of invisible technology, invisible processes. The blurb that we give you speaks about the under-the-hood mechanisms that the technologies enable the cities. And actually one of the speakers yesterday said exactly that, said something about how the technology of smart cities is invisible. We're trying to get away from this. Yes, smart cities imply, you know, the possibilities of having sensors deployed in our buildings and neighborhoods, gathering data that can be utilized in optimizing some services, in creating certain efficiencies, you know, with traffic, waste management, etc. That's part of it. I think the greatest potential is with the technology not only being visible, but actually enabling new ways of actually using the city, being present in the city, interacting with other people in the city. So it's not under the hood. It's very much visible. It's very much one of the things that is very clearly enabling us to do certain new activities in the cities. And this is what we want you to think about. The question is, how can we make our public spaces better with the use of technology? Why do we want to make them better? Because there is a sense that actually public spaces are perhaps suffering because so much of the activity now that we associate with the public arena has been evacuated from the public spaces and now is actually in the blogosphere, in the infosphere, it's happening online. think about Facebook, social media, etc. There's so much activity there. It's intense, but it's not something that is animating public spaces, right? It's not out there in the world. It's in the what we call the infosphere. But I think there is a way to bring that activity down, so to speak, to have an impact on the physical world. We want to capitalize on this intense social activity that has been enabled by those technologies and actually bring it back to the public arena. Yesterday, I met those of you who were here. I mentioned this great app developed for Dolores Park in San Francisco that actually helps people find in the public space their friends, their Facebook friends. So this is an interesting example that allows you to see how there may be a link between that intense activity online and the public arena. There are other, I have two minutes left. There are other examples I can actually read. Chris was, and I were did a workshop like this in India a few months ago in Ahmedabad, and one of the groups came up with this great idea of having a constellation of stations in a public park that are described as almost like electronic soapboxes. So people go there, they have an issue they want to discuss, they initiate a conversation, that conversation is broadcast online, there is an app, there's also a website where people everywhere can actually hear or see a transcript of that conversation. People gather, they know then that the topics are declared and people go to choose one of the topics they want to address. It's all broadcast online. People can participate at home, adding comments. And there is a way to provide feedback to the live conversation with the LEDs that change in color for like or dislike. So there's a feedback provided by the global community. So it's an interesting way to bring what is often happening online in various public or social media platforms where there's an intense conversation, but bring it actually landed, anchored in a social public space. Another project I'd like to mention, and I will leave, is a student of mine who did a thesis project on how we can use public spaces for learning opportunities. So this was developed for people who are trying to learn a second language, and this was designed for the public space in Toronto, and it went with an app that told you when you arrived at that public space, if you are interested in a particular language, it tells you where to go, where there's a group forming of people who are trying to learn that same language. So it's like the Dolores Park app. Basically, it helps people find others with like-minded interests or desires for learning and aggregate them in a particular learning environment. So those are two examples that show you how you can bridge between the infosphere, the sphere of social media, and real public spaces. Those are very clearly smart city applications. So you can see how that's a far cry from the cliche of the smart city as some kind of under the hood network of sensors that is gathering data to serve the needs of corporations and getting more money out of it. That's not at all what the smart city is all about. It could be that, but there is so much more. And what is most important for this workshop is there's so much more in the potential of reinventing public spaces reanimating them to make them vibrant, compelling environments that build the bridge between the intense activity online and the material world. So thank you. I'll come back later to mingle and see what you guys are up to. And see you later.
Inspired by this idea of ripples, and at the center of these ripples were what people were talking about most. So the most important, let's say, hashtags or the current use of, or the most popular hashtag being used now will be at the center of each of these ripples and the latest. And then while, you know, the ripple or the waves outside of each center will be decreasing time, or let's say the later tweets or the less recent tweets would be further away from the center of each ripple circle. And so then they would be, I guess, represented within these pavers. And so you can communicate with these tiles through this app. So I can create a tweet, and it's kind of an idea about what is being said most currently now that you can activate through public space. So this is a connection of social media, and then a diagram of exactly the representation of where the most current tweets are at the center, and then anything later would be further out from the center of the circle. And then a quick render. Another example, perhaps, is much more simple, but it does kind of showcase the idea that we are visualizing or showcasing what the data is being collected at where the sensor is located. So in this case, we just created a simple box for a sound sensor, and it would change between being happy or sad. So there's a servo motor connected to an Arduino, and basically, if it's too noisy, if it's too loud, sorry, it would be sad. And if it's quiet, it would be happy. And so it's just a simple sort of sensor box that showcases, hey, the data that we're collecting right now, it's too loud, and that could potentially change behaviors of visitors around this particular sensor box. And so there was an interface that was connected to this. This was showcased at eMERGE last year, showcasing the different ambient noise levels. Renders of where it could be at, and versus quiet versus loud. And then finally, this project is more, so you can think of this, these family of sensors in many ways. One, are they visualizing data for that single sensor, or is it an aggregate of perhaps sensors around, maybe four or five within, you know, a 1 mile radius, and there's a visualization display that showcases the aggregation of that smaller group of sensors? Or are you going to perhaps think of a visualization tool for the average of all of the sensors around a particular city? And so this is a project that was shown a little bit yesterday, and it's a facade system that uses algae within a public space. And so we proposed that we use algae within transparent containers, and each of these containers would have individually addressable LEDs. And so by doing so, we could essentially control the amount of growth within each container. So the more light that gets into that particular container, the more the algae grows, the greener it gets. So you can start to think of each container as a living monochromatic pixel. That when you amalgamate across the surface, it could become a display. But in this case, algae has many beneficial properties, such as carbon sequestration, water filtration, and it could be used as a biofuel. So the idea is that you could potentially hook it up to the building's rainwater or gray water supply and use this facade system to clean that water. You could hook it up to the building's HVAC system and sequester carbon in that sense. And when the image is done, you could essentially replenish the image, but use that algae as a biofuel. So it's a sort of system in which it's all being used. And in this particular case, we proposed it for the Museum of Science, in which there was a plaza below and a public space, and using this display as a visualization tool. And in this case, this bar graph is showcasing water conservation per capita of each neighborhood within Miami. And it's kind of comparing and contrasting and perhaps inciting some change between the different neighborhoods to conserve more water. And then a plan of this particular proposal, and then a section. So how is this done? So I guess I'm going to move towards, I mean, there's an app, so you can connect individuals to the public space. Perhaps it could be a public participatory method in which what kind of image gets displayed, a connection to the space without having to physically be there, and then a rendering of it in place. So how is this done? And perhaps we have a wide variety of individuals from different fields. So I guess that's the second presentation. And so it's a brief introduction into sensors, and perhaps for those of you who are familiar, this is very introductory. But just to get an idea, I think today it's more about the conceptual idea, but perhaps it can give you some information about how it would work, or how would you implement it. So, physical computing is essentially an interactive physical system made up of sensors and actuators that hook up to a microcontroller, which you can think of it as essentially a really dumb computer. And they essentially work with the physical world, both analog and digitally. And so, really the bread and butter is the Arduino, which came out in 2007. From Italy. The Arduino is a piece of hardware. It's about 1,000 times, let's say, dumber than the computer that we use today. But it's really great for individuals who don't have any sort of electrical engineering background or any coding background. And so the Arduino is the hardware, and the Arduino IDE is the software in which you're essentially coding what to do, what the Arduino should do. So you can essentially plug in a number of different sensors into the Arduino, and this could be, and then there's a quick slide about all of, there's a plethora of sensors and there's a plethora of actuators. So you can plug in any sort of actuator into it, and that could be anything from, or sorry, any sort of sensor into it, and that could be anything from as simple as a switch. And then you can plug in any sort of actuator, which could be as simple as an LED, and write a little sketch onto the Arduino to say, hey, if the switch turns on, turn on my light. Or you can connect a temperature sensor and say, hey, if the temperature is above 32 degrees, turn on my light. So this is where, you know, the Arduino in conjunction with the sort of personable 3D printer has kind of spawned the entire maker culture, and you can kind of make anything and everything now. But of course, we're looking in the context of smart cities, public spaces, and architecture. And so this is a sort of a breakdown of the different parts of the Arduino. It operates, or it connects with about 5 volts of sensors and actuators. So there are a number of sensors and actuators that are meant for the Arduino. But you can also control things outside of, you know, sensors and actuators meant for the Arduino. So you could theoretically, you know, control your dishwasher or your coffee machine using an Arduino. So they have about 13 digital I/O pins, so those are different outputs, and about 5 analog. So digital, when I'm referencing digital, I mean essentially it can either be turned on or off, so it's very black and white. So basically a light switch would be on or off, whereas analog is a sort of gradient, so it could be a spectrum of values or outputs or inputs, and that could be, let's say, brightness level for an LED. So they do have family products. It is open source, so you could make your own, although they do sell a family of products. And these are a number of other products related to the Arduino family that deal with specific situations and installations. So the Arduino Pro is meant for something more permanent. There's something where you solder your inputs and outputs. You have the Arduino Mini or the Arduino Nano, which are much smaller, so if you're looking for something much tighter space, you more than likely use the Arduino Mini or the Arduino Nano. The Arduino Mega, which is meant for projects that are much bigger, has a much more powerful processing unit, and it has many more digital input outputs as well as analog inputs and outputs as well. The Arduino LilyPad is meant for wearables, perhaps not relevant today, but just for information that you can sew on one of these chips onto, let's say, clothing, and make them interactive. And the Arduino UN is meant for the Internet of Things in the sense that it has already a Ethernet port onto the board. And so these are, you know, a subset of actuators. I think that we do have a kit a couple kits that you can kind of look at to get an idea, but actuators are things that are essentially output. So LEDs are the most basic, DC motors, servo motors, or stepper motors. Stepper motors are more used within 3D printing. They're very accurate. DC motors is more like a fan, for example, spinning like a tire, for example. Linear actuator moves in a single direction. Fan, LCD displays, etc. I mean, there's an entire family of sensors. Actuators. And then conversely, sensors. So anything from force sensors, motion sensors, proximity sensors. So motion sensors operate only either on or off. So it only detects whether there's movement in front of you or not. Whereas infrared proximity sensors.